Hello and welcome back to the final segment of our talk with Ms. Ramya Krishnamurthy. After an interesting first session where we spoke about the myths and misinformation around mental health, this session will focus more on how to actually go out and seek help for your mental health. So Ramya, I think in the last session we spoke about a lot of conditions. You know, you mentioned a few, you know, symptoms which people do notice when it comes to, you know, distress, whether it's, you know, you notice a fall in productivity, change in sleeping cycle, etc. Other than that, what are some early signs that, you know, an individual should look out for to know that, you know, that they should seek out help and, you know, reach out to a professional for their mental health?
Okay. So usually when a person, you know, is having a mental health issue, be it depression, be it anxiety, they would usually notice that, you know, everything is becoming an effort. They may have a lot of negative thoughts. They may feel sad. A lot of people say that I feel sad for no reason, or I feel anxious for no reason. It is usually because they are not aware of the negative cognitions or the negative thoughts that are going on in their mind, because people in general are not aware. Like, you know, they don't have a tendency to, you know, always go around thinking about what they're thinking, right? Or to notice or observe what they're thinking. So, but some people do notice that. They notice that, you know, they may be lying in bed and there will be a lot of thoughts that come to them. What they did wrong, maybe if they could have done it better, if they have certain guilt feelings. So these subtle signs that start coming in, when you don't feel good, when you don't feel like yourself, for days at a time, when you feel like everything is an effort, nothing is feeling good, even things that, you know, that you like to do before, you don't find pleasure in it anymore. You just don't see the point. You keep getting this thought, or you keep telling yourself, what's the point in going to meet my friends? What is the point in going and meeting my cousins? There's no point to any of it. Why do I need to? It's just so much effort. Let me just stay home. Let me just go back to sleep. You know, they may also notice that, you know, they are not eating well, or they are losing weight, or they are gaining weight for no reason. They are eating excessively, maybe. Or sometimes they may be using, you know, they may have, some people, they start drinking more, they start smoking more to cope with whatever is going on. They may justify it, they may rationalize it by saying, okay, I'm really stressed out at work, so I'm having, you know, maybe I'm smoking a little more. But that is also a problem, because stress needs to be dealt with. You need to know how to cope with that without having to use a substance as a crutch to get you through something. Right. So these are some of the signs that they can look out for, mainly how it starts affecting your functioning, basically. So sleep issues, appetite issues, you know, productivity issues. Maybe your productivity as such is not going, but you feel like you have to make more effort. More fatiguing. It's more tiring to do the same thing you used to be able to do. These are some of the subtle signs. And at any time, if you feel like, you know, there is something wrong, or there may be something wrong, there's nothing to going to a professional and just taking a consult and asking them what is going on. So just as, you know, when we have, say, fever, and fever is really difficult these days. Let us say a person has a headache, and you know, they go to the doctor and say, I've been having headaches for a few days. So you would still go to them, right? You wouldn't think twice about it. Or you have a toothache for a few days and you go to the doctor and I've had this toothache. So there's nothing wrong in saying, you know, I don't feel good and I don't feel very productive. So can you please help me out, and see what is going wrong?
I think, you know, as you said, I mean, just to add to it, I think, you know, how helplessness and hopelessness tend to go together when it comes to, you know, seeing that distress in people. And also, I just add one more thing, is that, you know, you lose that sense of enjoyment. And that's when you know things are, you know, a little difficult, when things that you previously enjoyed no longer seem to give you that feeling. I think, you know, just to add to everything else, that's also, I'd say, a sign to, you know, reach out, seek help. So when it comes to seeking help, you know, okay, now someone's decided that, okay, I need help. So the next step is to know what kind of help is required. And very often, you know, terms like, you know, psychologist and counselor and therapist are used, again, very interchangeably. So can you throw some light on, you know, how to decide whether you need to see you know, whether you need therapy or you need counseling.
Okay, so the main difference between counseling and therapy is a matter of clinical severity. Okay, so if a person, say, is only having certain adjustment issues, let us say a couple doesn't really have a lot of issues, they have more or less a good relationship, but they've hit sort of a rough patch. So then I would say, you know, a counselor is more required, a marital counselor, not just any counselor, a counselor who is trained in marital counseling will be the person to go. But let us say that they've had issues for a very long time. Both of them are going through a very difficult phase. One of them may be depressed. One of them may have more anger issues. Or, you know, or their personalities just don't seem to match at all. Or, you know, they just seem to keep clashing over many periods of time. A lot of people, ever since they are married, they may have issues. So when it is more deep-rooted, when you see that it is affecting everything, of course, any issue will, any marital issue, if I call it that way, it will affect, but it's a matter of intensity. So if you see that, you know, personalities are not matching at all, it is, you know, family is getting involved and, you know, there are a lot of, it's affecting the family as well. It's not restricted to just one aspect of the argument. And, you know, it's not something that is resolving. Then you go for therapy. Okay, so right. A person who, there are a lot of school counselors also. School counselors usually deal with, you know, certain issues like, you know, bullying, school-related issues.
School,
but
yeah.
Let us say that a child is extremely depressed or, you know, they usually go for therapy. They go for, yeah. You know, more, it's a matter of clinical diagnosis, basically. Clinical severity, if it matches a disorder, if it matches a diagnosis, then usually, you know, they need to be referred to a clinical psychologist or a proper trained therapist, psychotherapist.
Okay, so, you know, in addition to, you know, knowing, okay, you know, you've got the right kind of support, the equation that you build with your professional also, you know, holds a very important role in terms of your recovery process. So what are some things, you know, someone should keep in mind when selecting a counselor or a therapist?
Okay, so one of the first things that a person needs to look for is whether they are properly trained. So if you are going to a clinical psychologist, make sure that they have an MPhil degree, make sure that they have a license. They usually have a license from the Rehabilitation Council of India, the RCI. You have to ask them for the RCI number. Everybody has an RCI number. It's usually in their prescription or it's on their badge somewhere. It is definitely written somewhere. If it's not, then you need to ask them. That is one thing. You need to make sure that they are properly qualified, properly trained in hospital setting. They're properly trained in dealing with the issue that you're going with. So usually clinical psychologists and the training that is given to them is very holistic. So they are trained to see children, they are trained to see people with schizophrenia, they are trained to see people with borderline personality disorder, they are trained to see people with depression, anxiety, psychosis, bipolar, whatever.
Right.
So it's very intensive training that takes 2 years. People have, you know, they do training in hospital, especially if they have done it from a government college, they may have hospital experience also, they may have, you know, they may have had duties in the different clinics, the child clinic, the rehabilitation clinic, all of that. So that is one thing to look out for when you're selecting a professional. The second thing when that you need to see a rapport establishment of, you know, when we say therapeutic alliance,
yeah.
Is always a trial and error.
Yeah.
Yeah, it is always a trial and error. So a clinical psychologist may be really good or the patient may, or the, sorry, the client may be really cooperative, but their perspective or their, you know, their personalities may not match.
True.
A person, say a clinical psychologist, is empathetic, but they are, say, a little more strict, say. So
right.
They are very, or I won't say strict because we are not supposed to be strict. We are supposed to be flexible. So let us say that, you know, they are more staid. They are more, you know, they don't smile a lot, but they do
right.
Care. They do tell you that, you know, these are
yeah.
The things that are happening. They give you a proper formulation. They do everything, but they are very professional. So some people may not like that. They don't want the therapist to be professional. They want them to be friendly. They want
more
them to
friendly.
Be,
yeah.
You know, outgoing and smiling. And or if not smiling, then at least outgoing, be funny, be humorous.
Yeah.
A lot of people may not be that.
Yes, some
So,
people do want, as you said, that friendliness in your therapist. I mean, are you looking for a friend? Are you looking for someone who's just going to hear you
No,
out?
they may not be looking for a friend,
But
but
that
they may want
friendly
that person to be
quotient.
a little more lively. Yes, yes.
And
So
some of
I've
them
noticed
may
this
not be.
specifically. Yes, I've noticed this specifically with more young adults, those who are still in college. They want someone who's, kind of cool, and they'll talk to them in their on their terms. They'll use certain examples that they can relate to. So, talking about Rabindranath Tagore may not you
Very
may
true.
not connect with them. Talking
Very
to
true.
them about Phineas and Ferb may, help, or talking about maybe Harry Styles, or anyone, Emma Watson. They
Right.
like that sort of thing. So it's about personalities matching. Also, as a therapist, what we usually try to do is we try to, at least, like portray ourselves in a way that, makes the person feel comfortable.
Right.
But a lot of times that doesn't happen. Because the person, we are also people, we are also human. Some people feel more comfortable in being professional. They don't want to be, always smiling. And, they may find it fake. They may themselves find it fake. They say that, yes, I care, but I can't, keep smiling and talk about, other issues when, I see that this person is going through trouble. So I need to be professional. So alliance and a rapport is usually always a trial and error matter. But most of the time, it does work because we are flexible. We do try to, to explain things or to connect with the person in a way that will make them feel comfortable. That is usually the case.
See, there's also this other notion that, for your mental health conditions to be managed, it's almost essential that you need to take psychiatric medication. Do you really feel that's the case?
Okay, so psychiatric medications, people have a lot of misconceptions about it. Psychiatric medications are not always harmful. They come with side effects, with just as any medication comes with side effects. So those side effects are not usually permanent. They also come and go. A lot of people will have antidepressants in the beginning. They'll find that they may not be able to sleep, or their appetite is, or they feel a little more nauseous. But eventually, as they have them over a small period of time, they'll notice that it's becoming okay. Like they feel better. Their appetite is fine. Their sleep is getting improved, in fact. So a lot of people have misconceptions about psychiatric medications, but usually, as the American Psychological Association says, which we follow, is that if a person has more milder symptoms, they may not need medications. They may do well with therapy. But let us say a person has moderate to severe problems, then they need some medications to make them a little more stable, to make sure that, their basic functions are at least taken care of. So at least if a person is always plagued by sleep, if they are always affected by bad appetite, then they are so focused on that they will not be able to go on into the deeper issues, because the major issues are not being taken care of. So the medications are just there to help you to function a little more normally, to come back to that level of functioning. And then therapy will take over and help you to solve your problems, to help you to cope with certain issues. Because medications are not going to do that. Medications are not going to solve your problems.
Right.
They are only there to give you support and to give you some mental stability, so that whatever you learn in therapy, or whatever you talk about in therapy, you can apply in real life.
Right.
That is the use of medications. Now, usually medications are given when it is more moderate or severe, or there are multiple functions that are being affected, then medications are given. Otherwise, yes, a lot of times I've had people with mild depression, with mild anxiety, who do well with just therapy as well. They don't need medications. But it is always better to leave it up to the clinical psychologist to decide whether they need a psychiatrist referral or not. It's always better to leave that decision up to them.
So Ramya, can you tell us a little bit more about, what a clinical psychologist actually does?
Okay. A clinical psychologist is basically, as I said, a person who has done a two-year MPhil clinical psychology course from an RCI registered institute. So there are government institutes and there are private ones also, but they need to have an RCI license to teach. So you will find a list of institutes by the RCI in their website. So the ones who have gotten the renewal, the ones who have the new license and everything, it's a exhaustive list of the of all of the institutes that are available all over India. Now, a clinical psychologist, there are many roles that they do. One is assessment, the other one is therapy. Assessment as in, you know, when you need a diagnostic clarification, when you need to know a little bit more about what is going on. You need to be trained, you need to know how that person, you know, so what we do is something like a pathology formulation. How right. that person has come to this point where they are depressed or whether, you know, or with schizophrenia. What are the factors that are affecting them? What are the factors that are maintaining the symptoms? What are the factors that may aggravate these symptoms, that may increase them, that may decrease them? And what are the things in their particular life or in their timeline that has brought about these symptoms? So all of this we learn as we learn assessments, because assessments are basically diagnostics. So we need to know exactly what diagnosis they have. That is one. And secondly, to formulate a pathology formulation as to how this person is where they are now.
Right.
And once we do that, we go into therapy. Not we don't always do a diagnostic clarification, because sometimes it's a very clear-cut case as usual. As it goes. When there is confusion, then we do assessments. And when it is more clear-cut, we go directly to therapy. So therapy, there are a lot of therapies that a person is trained in. But some of the basic ones, one of the most used ones is cognitive behavior therapy.
Right.
Then there is behavior therapy, which is mainly used for children, who have maybe mood issues, or they have ADHD or attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, or they have intellectual disability issues. So there are many therapies that a clinical psychologist is trained in, very basic ones. And then whichever ones that interest them, they try to learn more about it. They go and they get more training, or they get more information about it. So we do both assessment and therapy. We are, we have certain knowledge about drugs, but we don't prescribe them. It is only to know how far the person is affected by a medication, or whether it is a symptom of what they're going through. So that is basically the role of a clinical psychologist.
Lovely. So you mentioned a lot about, you know, therapy as part of your role. And there is again a misconception around therapy that it's often just like a talking cure. You know, you go in, you talk to somebody, you keep talking, and that's what a session would end up being like. Mm-hmm. Can you tell us a little bit more about how that actually works? You know, the therapy process, how does it work? Because therapy is definitely more than, you know, just you go and you talk to somebody. No, there's much more involved in it. There's a lot of science behind it. As you said, there's so many fields of therapy, whether it's occupational therapy, CBT, behavioral therapy. So can you tell us a bit more on how therapy really works?
Yes. So this misconception is the reason why you will see there are so many people just mushrooming around calling themselves a psychologist. There are people who have barely finished their bachelor's, or they may just have finished their bachelor's and they call themselves a psychologist and start practicing.
Right.
There are people who may have done some basic course in counseling and start doing that. So therapy is not only a talking cure. We use talking as a medium to elicit certain things, but it is not a talking cure. It is more like, you know, let us say that a person is depressed. They tell me their symptoms. And I ask a lot of questions. I ask them, you know, what are the things that, you know, increase that may increase what you are feeling. Let us say that a person presents with a depressed mood most of the time, difficulty in sleeping, they are not able to concentrate, they feel fatigued all of the time, and they don't feel like meeting people, they don't feel like meeting their friends. So they have the three major criteria. They've matched the three major criteria for depression. One is a depressed mood, one is a loss of interest in activities, and the other one is fatigue and decreased energy. So these, when we see that this person has this particular diagnosis, what we do, as I said, we do a formulation for that person. So a lot of times there might have been childhood experiences. Everybody has childhood experiences. True. Now, depending on what kind of therapy that you do, let us say if you do cognitive behavior therapy or cognitive therapy, then usually we say that a person has had certain childhood experiences which may have you know, brought about certain rigid beliefs, or the way they see their world is usually shaped in childhood. So they have certain schemas, they have certain, you know, beliefs about the world, about themselves also. So as time goes on, there might be a triggering event, or they might have gone through a stressful event. Let us say a breakup in a relationship, or, you know, they're having difficulty in getting a job, or they may have lost a loved one, anything. So when there is a triggering event, it brings about certain, you know, more negative cognitions. And, you know, it affects their behavior, it affects their emotions. So when we formulate this, we have a particular model that we place. There are many models, even in cognitive therapy, there are many models by different people. And we try to see which model best suits that person, or if any model does not suit them, we can always make an individualized model for them. We call that a pathology formulation. How that person came to this particular point in their life, or came to this particular issue, or why they have this particular issue. From there, we formulate a therapy plan. So we say that we have certain goals. The first session is about the therapeutic alliance. It's about saying, you know, it's about establishing goals. What are the goals in therapy? So therapy does not always go lifelong. If it is more mind, it is more time constrained. So we give them a target. We say that, okay, your issues may be resolved in, say, 10 to 12 sessions. May be resolved. Once it is 10 to 12, from there, we will tell you where you stand and what we can do. So when we do the therapy formulation, we have certain goals in mind. We have short-term goals and we have long-term goals. So short-term goals may be their sleep problems. It will be their appetite issues. Maybe they are feeling anxious sometimes. The person who is depressed can also feel anxious.
Of course.
So without meeting the criteria for an anxiety disorder, they may still be anxious. So to reduce that anxiety, what are the factors that are involved in them not having enough sleep? Do they lie in bed and, you know, they think a lot, they have a lot of ruminations, they overthink and they worry a lot before they go to sleep, which is why they are not able to go back to sleep. Do they have bad sleeping habits? So we use talking as a medium, but we are, you know, there are a lot of techniques involved in trying to elicit the things that we want to see. So let us, a person who is depressed, we may ask them, you know, what are the sort of thoughts that you have? Do you notice any pessimistic thoughts? Do you notice any negative thoughts? How those thoughts are connected to the way they feel? How it is connected to the way they behave? So as I said, a person may think, what is the point in going out? Why should I go meet my friends? There is no point to any. So what do? They feel bad, they feel lazy. And their final behavior is that they go back to sleep, or they avoid social situations. So they avoid meeting friends. So, this is the way that therapy usually works in a cognitive framework. This is, of course, in a cognitive framework. If you say that if it's a child and, you know, if it's a young child who has behavioral issues, who is maybe, who has intellectual disability, which used to be called mental retardation. We don't call it mental retardation anymore. We call it intellectual disability. So when a child with ID comes in, we don't do cognitive therapy because they can't think about their thoughts.
They won't process.
So then we put it into a behavioral perspective.
Right.
What are the factors that, you know, aggravate certain behavioral problems? We also sometimes, specifically in behavior therapy, that certain children, they don't know how to dress themselves. They don't know how to bathe themselves. The things that, you know, children usually learn by themselves, they don't learn because they are not able to pick it up fast enough.
The milestones.
So we give them, so we give them training. There are certain techniques that are involved in giving them training like that. We, there is something called shaping and chaining, where, you know, we teach them each step one by one. We use certain techniques like reinforcement. We reward the child for small steps that they are able to take, so that they are more and more interested, so that they get more and more involved in doing things by themselves. So there are a lot of techniques involved. It's not just about talking. Depending on the kind of therapy that you do, there is art therapy, there is psychodynamic therapy.
Right.
So all of them, they have a lot of techniques. There are a lot of theoretical basis to that, which require a lot of training. It is not only about talking and saying, oh, they're there. It's not like that.
Right. See, one of the things that, you know, which comes with mental health and seeking health is like this lack of understanding that how long do we have to wait to see signs of improvement? Which, like, you know, for instance, if it's a fracture, I know that within X number of weeks, my fracture will heal. Or if I have, you know, fever, I know that, you know, if I take XYZ tablet, within so many hours, I will show signs of improvement. But in mental health, you know, typically, how long do you feel that a person needs to stick with, you know, the therapy or the counseling to actually start seeing signs?
Okay. First of all, a person needs to be in therapy for the stipulated number of sessions that the clinical psychologist has said they need. So a lot of people, they will notice a change in, say, 1-2 sessions. A lot of people will notice changes after 4-5 sessions. So depends on the amount of, you know, amount of techniques that they're able to apply in real life. When they go back home, how much are they able to apply it? How much they understood what happened? So as we go along, we keep psychoeducating the person. We keep telling them, okay, this is why, you know, this is how this is happening. These are the things that are affecting this particular problem. So look about it this way, change your perspective, see how you can see it in a different way. So the more that they're able to do things like that, the faster the improvement will be. So it is not a be all and end, and it's not, there's no set number of days like that. So if it's a fracture, even a fracture can heal in different ways, depending on the person's age, depending on the person's health, depending on other conditions that they may have. So what is the healing factor for that particular person? It may also vary for them as well. So even in mental illness, it varies because of the, you know, how far they're able to, you know, apply what is given to them, how far they're able to understand what happened, you know, how far they're able to relate to what was said in therapy also. Now, that is as far as, you know, how far they can stick to it. They should stick to it. Even if they see that, you know, they are more or less back to normal. So a lot of people, they don't, you know, clients who come to me, they don't have major symptoms of depression, but they're still having certain issues. But they feel like, okay, I feel a little normal now. I'm okay now. I don't need any more therapy. So that is not right, because even after all of that, we do something called relapse prevention, where we teach the person what they can look out for, how they can make sure that they don't relapse, so that it doesn't repeat. So that this episode does not repeat. So they need to finish the whole therapy course without stopping in between. Now, even during therapy, so before we start therapy, we usually make a baseline. Let us say if a person has OCD, we give them the, you know, the questionnaire or the rating scale for OCD. We see the amount of severity they have, each symptom of OCD. OCD is not always only one thing. It is not only cleaning.
Yeah.
They'll have cleaning. They'll have hand washing. They'll have organizing.
Counting.
They'll have a lot of things. Yes, a lot of counting, a lot of things. So all of those symptoms, how far they have decreased in intensity, we keep doing a reassessment after every few sessions, let's say every 4 sessions or every 5 sessions, to see. A lot of people may not see a change. They may say that I don't see any difference. But when you actually do the assessment, you see that, yes, it has decreased in intensity maybe, or it has decreased in frequency. A person who used to wash their hand 12 times, now they wash their hand 9 times. That is still an improvement. That is still, yes, that is still improved. So that is how we objectively see how much improvement has happened or how much change has happened. Other than that, a person will usually feel good as far as they try to apply the things that are taught in. But there is no set limit like that.
Okay. See, and one thing that you just mentioned is that very often people feel that, you know, no, now I'm okay and I want to stop this process.
Yes.
Or they just tend to, you know, drop out of therapy for a variety of reasons. I mean, one of them is definitely that they feel they've recovered. But can you, you know, shed a little more light on why, you know, other than that, if there are any more reasons which you've come across in your experience, why people drop out of therapy and how we can prevent them from dropping out from therapy, other than, you know, making those plans, setting goals, having milestones, how else can we stop that from happening?
Okay, so a lot of people drop out of therapy because they feel like there has been no change. And usually there is no change because they are not applying what is being told to them in therapy. So usually these clients are also ones who don't come to therapy very regularly. they'll come, say, maybe if I ask them to come once in 2 weeks, even if they are not, you know, financially, like I'm saying that even if they don't have any other problems, they are, they don't, like logistically there are no issues. Even in spite of that, they may not come back. They'll come after a month, they'll come after 2 months.
Yeah, I mean,
because firstly, they may not have enough insight. They may not have, you know, even after we psychoeducate. So psychoeducation also takes a few sessions. Like we need to keep explaining to them that this is also something that that happens to people. These are the things that you need to look out for. These are the things that are affecting how you feel and affecting what you're going through. So try to, you know, target each one of them. Try to change each one of them.
Right.
So that is one reason why, because they don't understand that, you know, and honestly, because I, you know, a lot of people, they say therapy is very hard work. Because, you know, if it is medication, you just pop a pill and you just go about your day.
Yeah.
But in therapy, you actually have to change a lot of things. You have to change your, change the way you do certain things. It's a lifestyle change when you go into therapy. So a lot of things, like, you know, sometimes I give meditation to, you know, my clients. So a meditation needs to be a part of their routine after a while. It is the way that it's a way of stress busting, or it's a way of releasing all of that anxiety they have. So that needs to become a part of their routine. A lot of people are resistant to change that way. They don't want to change. They just want to keep doing the same things and expect improvement, which doesn't happen.
And I think
is why after a few days or a few sessions, they realize that, okay, this is not working out, or, you know, maybe this person is not good, or, you know, therapy is just not useful, and they drop out. And another reason is also because of many financial issues. So people genuinely have financial issues. Therapy may not be very expensive, but depending on where you go, a lot of government hospitals are inexpensive. You don't need to pay you don't need to pay for the medications, nor do you need to pay for the sessions either. But there are other issues involved. They may live very far away. Wherever they are, it may not be accessible. In spite of that, if the person does drop out of therapy, it is usually because of those reasons that, you know, they don't want to, you know, make significant changes, or they are not able to apply what is said in therapy, because for whatever reason, however, some people are resistant to change also because of, you know, the way that they are, or you know, the way that, you know, the way they are, like their personality characteristics and all of that. And of course, then people usually drop out because they see some change and they feel like I'm better, so I don't need it anymore. These are the two or three major factors why people may drop out of therapy. One may be logistical reasons. Two is because they are not able to follow what is said in therapy. And three is because they noticed a change and they are so happy and they are like, okay, I'm done. Decide by themselves.
As you said, you know, sometimes, like, in terms of being irregular for sessions, it's quite common for people to feel that, you know, hey, today I'm not having a bad day, so I can skip today. Like, therapy is not something you just go to on a bad day. You know, you have to stick with it, good day, bad day. And that is something people don't realize. And, like, your therapist is not your SOS call per se. You know, it's someone who's going to be there throughout the process, so that you don't have to have SOS calls, in a way.
Exactly.
And I don't know, do you feel to an extent sometimes even stigma associated with therapy, or, you know, like, people have found out that I'm in therapy, oh my God, I cannot continue this. You know, that maybe sometimes the stigma...
This is there. There is a fear that, you know, family members will also judge.
Find out.
A lot of my clients, you know, they... specifically, even if they are young adults, they understand that they need therapy. They understand that, you know, there are a lot of things. So they are very cooperative. That I have a very good therapeutic relationship with them.
Right.
And, you know, but in spite of that, they say that, you know, I can't bring my mother in. My mother can't know. I'm coming to sessions, you know, by doing tuitions, or, you know, by my own pocket money, I'm coming. But my mother can't know. My father can't know. My family can't know. My husband can't know. So, you know, even if I find later that, you know, even they say that, yes, my husband is very supportive. He himself has said that I may need counseling.
Yeah.
In spite of that, they are afraid to tell
them that we've started.
Yes.
Seeking
yes. Yes. Yeah.
Because I feel
So,
I mean, you know, somewhere I don't know whether this is a very cultural thing, especially in India, but sometimes I feel like the reason people don't want to tell others is they feel that the other people around them, like, you know, as you said, okay, my husband supports me to go seek therapy, but you feel that that person is going to start blaming themselves for you being in that position.
Yes.
You know, they feel, you know, humne to, we've done so much for you. Why are you still like this? So, I mean, that's, you know, another conversation altogether. But coming back
and
to...
And people also have the fear, people also have this fear that they are a burden to people.
Yeah.
You know, depressed will always feel like I'm a burden to, you know, my family. They're spending so much money on me and they're spending so much money for the doctors and the counselors and everything.
This idea that you're letting people down, you know, by being in therapy or struggling with your mental health definitely needs to change.
Yes.
But I think, you know, gradually these kind of conversations, if people talk about it, come out about it, hopefully that will make people have that confidence that it can change. You know, coming back to...
And it's usually because they, you know, there is this ingrained belief that, you know, you can always snap out of mental illness. Maybe not snap out like that, but it is, you know, it is something that you can just, okay, just deal with it now. Ho to gaya. You're going there. Just deal with it. Okay, you're getting angry. Don't be angry anymore. Do what they're saying. Just be, don't be angry anymore. Don't do this. So it's like, you know, they don't, even if family members, they are supportive, they come and they explain and, you know, they are trying to, they even come and ask me, ma'am, what can I do? What can I do so that this doesn't happen? What, how can I help her when this is happening? In spite of that, they, you know, at the end of the session, they'll say, okay, ma'am, can you please explain to her not to do this?
Exactly.
So I have explained everything and I've told them why they might be doing something, how something might be triggering whatever they are going, whatever they are doing. And they mean, and you know, none of that has just, you know, gone down.
It's that lack of awareness. You know, I feel maybe the next, you know, the coming generations are a bit more aware.
Yes,
of definitely. Their emotions, they are more aware of what they are going through, and I think they would be more open to those conversations. You know, coming back to your work in the clinical setting, can you talk about, like, you know, what is one challenge that, you know, you faced in your
challenge that I faced? Well, there are numerous. One of the major ones, specifically if it's a child, is you know, parents, there are a lot of specifically people who are more old-fashioned, they're more from the rural communities.
Right.
So they don't believe in mental illness. They say, you know, that, you know, they are possessed. Somebody has done black magic on them.
Right.
This is specifically when, you know, specifically children who are going through a dissociative episode. I don't know if you know what dissociation
is. Of course.
Dissociation is when a person has an altered state of consciousness. Yes. So some people faint,
some people just lose touch with reality.
Yes, yes. So they are a completely different person. They might have, you know, they'll just stare for no reason.
Yeah.
Or, you know, they might start abusing. They may use words that they don't use. A very calm child will, you know, be very angry and she'll start, you know, yelling and screaming at that person. And later she'll be like, no, I didn't say anything like that. I don't remember doing anything like that.
Right.
So, you, if it is not malingering and if it is not fake, then this is dissociation. So, when a person is dissociating, especially in, you know, in things like that, or when a person has schizophrenia, and they say that, you know, this person is following me, and somebody is trying to harm me, the CIA is after me.
Yeah, those like paranoid hallucinations, delusions.
Yes, when they hallucinate and when they have delusions like that. Family members, specifically in the rural areas, they have this tendency to think that the person is possessed. Yes, and they usually, the first thing that they do is take them to a priest or take them to a faith healer, and you know, they do all of whatever they do, and even then, and initially there is some improvement because there is like a placebo effect,
of course,
but after a few days, after a week or so, again it goes back. So then they realize, okay, there might be something else. They may go to a normal doctor and the doctor will say, okay, take them to a psychiatrist or take them to a clinical psychiatrist.
Right.
So that is usually what happens. You know, like it's mainly because they are not, they don't have enough awareness of what is going on. That is the reason why things like these happen.
So I'm going to come to the last question that, you know, I think which a lot of people would tend to, you know, have in mind. And we've spoken a lot about, you know, the symptoms or the signs to look out for, or, you know, how to get help and, you know, where to go, who to go to. But let's say as an individual, someone notices, like, you know, these sort of signs in a loved one. What is, like, something that they can do despite not having formal training in mental health? Like, you know, what can an individual do for somebody who they care about, who they notice in distress?
Okay. So usually a lot of things, the first thing that matters when you notice that your loved one is not, you know, the same way that they used to be, is to try to talk to them. Try to find out what is going on. What is their perspective? What is going on with them? Why, you know, you can tell them that, you know, I noticed that you are, you know, very quiet. You didn't used to be so quiet. Or you're not meeting me that often. What is wrong? You know, sometimes the person themselves may come out and say, you know, I feel very anxious and I don't feel good. I don't feel like, I feel very demotivated. Things like that. So the first thing that they need to do is just offer reassurance. Don't never ever say that, you know, don't be depressed. Don't be anxious, because it doesn't help. It's like telling a person with a broken arm, you know, fix your arm.
It's like you're not going to tell someone with asthma, ki, you know, there's so much air, why can't you breathe? Or try harder, like try harder.
Yes, exactly. Yes, very good point. So, you know, the first thing to do is to offer reassurance, tell them that, okay, I'm there for you. Why don't you tell me what is going on? We'll figure this out together. We'll find out what can be done. What is your reason for feeling sad? And they will have a reason. Sometimes it will be an irrational reason, but it is a reason nonetheless. Let us say that a person is, you know, feeling very low self-esteem because of a breakup, or because their boyfriend yelled at them, or, you know, they had a fight with their boyfriend, and they are experiencing low confidence. They maybe also already had low confidence, and they just feel that even more. They feel like they are not worth it, and all of that. So by saying that, you know, okay, don't feel less confident, chhod do usko, you know, all of that doesn't help. So you just offer, you know, a listening ear, just be there for them. And again, like, look for, you know, there are so many people who are available. Contact the nearest hospital where you live. You know, most hospitals these days, especially if they're multi-speciality, they do have
a
psychiatry department, or they have a psychology department. If not, the nearest clinic also will do. There are a lot of clinics that are available. We know how to look for a clinical psychologist to see, you know, to weed out the, following those guidelines, the way that you look for a doctor, you know, you ask people, or you go on the internet and you try to find out.
Right.
Same way, you can always, you know, there are, of course, I am available. There are a lot of people who are available also. On the internet, you can try to find out.
Yeah.
Hospitals, you can try to go there and see. So, you know, being there for them, doing small tasks for them, asking them what they need. Okay, you don't feel good today. How can I help you? Would you like me to send dinner for you today? Would you like to go for a walk after dinner? You know, would you like to listen to some music? Do you just want to sit, not talk? We just sit together. When you feel like talking, you talk to me. And, you know, let us, you know, maybe, you know, if this keeps on going, maybe we can go, you know, go to a professional. I'll be there with you. You don't need to go through this alone. Things like that, you know, so that the person knows that, okay, there is somebody there for them. I don't have to do this alone. And somebody understands. At least they're trying to understand what I'm doing. People, family members, they don't have training in mental illness. This is what you can do. Don't trivialize the issue. Don't tell them not to do it. But just be there. Just listen.
Exactly. I think, you know, as you said, that's the most important thing. I don't think if you want to help somebody, the last thing you should do is sort of invalidate their experience. And I think if you don't...
Even if they don't mean to do it, but it comes out that way.
But if we don't invalidate their experience, that will give them that sort of comfort or solace, you know, that they are looking for, that yes, they can talk to you. Yes, you are sort of a safe space.
Yes.
And then finally, just sort of signpost them to, you know, help available.
Yes.
I think it's been, a really, really informative session. So thank you so much, Ramya, for taking out so much time to speak to us. And for all our viewers, I'm sure there's been a lot of learning, a lot of insight that we're going to take back from this. So please keep a lookout on our space for more content. Turn on notifications, like, subscribe, and if you're going through any distress, please reach out for help because you absolutely do deserve to get better. And there is help available. There are people out there who care and will help you get through it. Thank you.